Well, good evening, everyone. As Father mentioned, this is our seventh session out of eight. So you are all to be congratulated for climbing this mountain together and with me, and I appreciate that very much. It's great to go through these great figures in the history of early Catholicism and Christianity with you. Malcolm Muggeridge one time was asked, how do you characterize the great figures of Christian history? And he used a kind of framework that I think is useful for thinking about the fathers of the church. You can study the fathers of the church as individuals, but they all have something in common that make them great, and in particular, Augustine tonight. So they're all quintessentially men of their time, but they also do something else. They relate their time in a significant way to eternity, and that's what makes them great. They're not just part of the contemporary scene that they lived in, but they relate God, they relate the timeless in time, if you will. And this is necessary for society, for mankind, from time to time. When the lure of our own self-sufficiency becomes so great, or when society is overwhelmed by despair, prophets are called from time to time to remind mankind of God, of humility, and the possibility of hope. In the Old Testament, the Jews had the prophets. In the New Testament, God became his own prophet through the incarnation, and prophets continue in the life of the church. You know, whether it's between the fantasies of our ego that is puffed up, between that and our vocation to love, between the darkness that can cloud our mind and heart to the light of truth and grace, there will always be a bridge and a prophetic voice calling us to cross over. And that's what great people do. They are that voice at the other side of that bridge that call us from a prior condition of alienation from God. So we come to Augustine, and Augustine, for me and for other thinkers, is more than just the greatest father of the church, which is generally not disputed, although someone here earlier wanted to dispute that with me before we even started the lecture, so I was warmed up already, hitting the speed bag and ready to go. But he is considered the greatest father of the church because, as Malcolm Muggeridge, in talking about Augustine, he fancied him to be like a latter-day Noah who built an ark to protect the church so that when the lights of Rome went out, orthodoxy would continue in the dark days that would come ahead. And this ark that Augustine built would travel through time, through the centuries, until, frankly, the creation of Europe, which is a unique creation of Christianity. And so through the wide-ranging thought of Augustine, we have this arc, if you will, that traveled through the centuries from, say, the 5th century on, even past Charlemagne in the 9th century, till medieval Christianity started to flourish. Augustine in the West was the Noah's Ark of Orthodoxy. So he is that kind of figure. He is that kind of man who so many trajectories of his thought. As I mentioned in class one, we could have spent the entire summer on just St. Augustine. So you'll forgive me if when I compress it into 90 minutes tonight, I may not get to your favorite topic of Augustine, but I want to cover the topics that I think are that connective tissue from one time to another. The one time is this dying pagan world. As Rome is being torn apart by the barbarians, if you think in 410 AD, Alaric sacks Rome, and the disintegration begins. The Roman Empire begins to fall apart significantly. We tend to underappreciate that when we look at it some 1600 years later. But in other classes, I've likened it to the collapse of the internet and air travel. It would be that kind of significance to society today is if someone told you you could no longer fly an airplane, you could no longer go on the internet, and maybe even automobiles not working anymore. That was the magnitude of the fall of Rome. And Augustine, almost providentially, was uniquely suited to the task of this transition from this dying pagan world to orthodoxy. So he's an emblem of an age that's dying and an age that was being born. Why do I say that? Because he was almost picked for the task, if you look at the autobiography or the biography of his life, whether it was being tempered in his sensuality, which he eventually overcame, or forged through this restless mind that was constantly questioning, trying every door on every outhouse, on every halfway house, trying to find wisdom and truth and love. He's this uniquely searching figure, and he reflects this transition from a pagan age that was dying and was exhausted to the new birth and new life in Jesus Christ, which would take time to seed the entire West and create, as I say, Western Europe. That's his significance. He is this hinge figure from the 5th century, and the trajectory went all the way through to medieval times and beyond. Aquinas in the Summa calls him, you know, the key theologian, and he was, and to some extent continues to this day. Benedict XVI had a predilection, if you will, for Augustine. It was a more organic theology that Benedict was looking to. The rigor of Thomism perhaps did not suit the sensibility of Benedict, but he viewed Augustine as the key theologian of the church. So with that, why don't we go to the next page on the background on St. Augustine. So he was born in approximately 354 and died in 430. The birth dates of most of ancient historical figures are always a bit uncertain because they didn't necessarily record them. Babies weren't really expected to live very long, so birth dates weren't really recorded. But he's thought to have been born around 354 AD. As I mentioned, one of the great doctors of the church, certainly, and he's, in my view, and it's not my view, it's more of the consensus view, that he's the greatest father of the church. He was born in Algeria, northern Algeria, in a town called Thagaste, to a Christian mother and a pagan father, Patricius. Monica, as you know, is the mother of Augustine, and her feast day is celebrated in August, as well as St. Augustine's. Augustine received a classical pagan education in the Roman Latin poets and writers of his time. He was very well versed in pagan thought and in Roman thought. He sought a career as a speechwriter, perhaps a doctor of rhetoric, what's called a rhetorician, writing speeches for dignitaries, for consuls, for proconsuls, for governors. He even wrote several speeches for the emperor. And even in the Confessions, he would remark that he was writing falsehoods for people who knew they were falsehoods, and after a while became an empty vocation for him. Nevertheless, continuing the chronology here, he goes to Carthage to further his studies. He's involved in various philosophical pursuits and hobbies, cults. He also retained a concubine, as they call it. He basically had a live-in girlfriend for 15 years, and they did bore a child named Adeodatus, which means God-given. He stayed with this concubine, who he never names, for 15 years. He returns home to teach grammar, but is still attracted by the allure of the power and prestige of Rome, so he goes back to Milan, where he falls under the tutelage of St. Ambrose, who was the Bishop of Milan. And through his association with Ambrose and others, he does eventually convert. Midstream, though, he sends his the woman he'd been living with, referred to always as a concubine, back to his home country. Some writers think that was because his mother, Monica, was preparing him for an arranged marriage with someone in society, someone who could advance his career. So he sends the woman of 15 years back to his homeland because she would be an embarrassment. There are other versions of that, but that seems to be the consensus view. But while he's there, there's the famous garden scene in Latin, tole et lege, take and read, where he hears the child while he is, his soul is in angst and is perplexed on should he convert, should he not, what does it mean to convert? And he hears a child either singing or saying a song, take and read. And so he rushes back to a friend where a Bible was, and he opens the Bible to the first passage that his eyes fall on and reads it. Because he recalled that St. Anthony, one of the original founders of monasticism, did the same thing to found the monastic groups that St. Anthony led. So Augustine, thinking this could be similar, opened it and read from Paul's letter, which I'll read to you later. This was his conversion moment, and after that there was really no looking back for Augustine. The restlessness of whether to be a Orthodox Catholic or not ended, but then it opened up a whole another series of restlessness on other Catholic questions. As he's traveling with his mother Monica, they share a mystical experience which he narrates in the Confessions. Some kind of mystical experience of heaven, the afterlife, which they found joyous. Or it could have been a contemplation of God that is often described by mystics. Shortly after that, she does pass away. And with that, Monica's earthly influence on him ends, but he continues to refer to it in his writings. Between the years, somewhere between 386 and 430, Augustine starts writing heavily. Augustine actually didn't particularly want to be a priest or later be a bishop. He actually wanted to be the founder of a community in private that would be contemplatives on Neoplatonic wisdom and, you know, in a garden somewhere protected from humanity, if you will. And that was not to be. He was plucked from that, and eventually, while he was traveling, he was made a priest. And while he was in Hippo, the bishop of Hippo of the time wanted to name him as his coadjutor, which means his assistant. Once he retires, his assistant would take over. Augustine wasn't really thrilled by that, because he knew what that would mean. And he would be ensconced in the midst of controversies which were afflicting North Africa at the time, and reluctantly took this on. But he knew it would be the end of his little private enterprise community of people reflecting on interesting theological and philosophical texts and discussing them amongst themselves. So he was in some way thrust into the ministry, reluctantly, but he did jump in with both feet. So oftentimes he would avoid traveling because he knew this might happen, and the one time he let his guard down traveling through Hippo, the people demanded that he be their next bishop. So that is a skeleton background. There's obviously much more flavor to his life, but that kind of gives you the bare bones of his background. The first text that I wanted to spend some time on is the Confessions. And this is a very interesting work, and it's an interesting work because we probably know more about Augustine than any other classical figure in history. We have an entire book dedicated to one man's life, if you will, his journey from childhood all the way to his conversion and then past it. It's probably the greatest work of spiritual autobiography we have. The fact that it is still read today, and when you consider it, it's 1600 years old, and it's treated with the same kind of regard as a modern work of biography. And when you read it, you forget that you're reading something that was written 1600 and some years ago. It's so contemporary still in our ears, and we'll get to some of those texts in a moment. In this work, he really is boiling down that there are two paths we can walk, you know, toward God and fulfillment, happiness, or a love of self with all of its unbounded appetites and fantasies, if you will, and turning away from God into these delightful, sinful pursuits, which he will spend some time talking about. You know, as I mentioned at the beginning, for me and for others, Augustine really is this symbol of the transition that I was talking about earlier, of the death of pagan society in the West, and the seeds are being planted for orthodoxy to continue, even though the political climate is going to be hostile to orthodoxy and disintegrate. For example, most of the barbarians were Arians, and we learned last week that Arians were heretical as it relates to their view of Jesus Christ. So more on that as we go, when we talk about some specific controversies. Ultimately, Christianity and Catholicism are true for Augustine because they respond to the deepest promptings and longings of the human heart. And this may be why Benedict thought he was very useful and important for today, is that in a former time, maybe in a medieval time, man found God through the order he saw in the universe. And reading the signs of the times today, perhaps Benedict was thinking that today we discover God through the disorder in ourselves. It's a different paradigm, but it's an interesting paradigm. And if you read the works of Benedict when he was Cardinal Ratzinger, and then later his encyclicals, oftentimes he is starting with the disquiet, the alienation we feel as a human being today as a starting point. So don't start with the system building of Aquinas, as robust and interesting to me as that is. Don't start with the order in the universe. Start with the disorder in all of us. And it's a very interesting starting point, and it could be something prophetic for our own time as well. Behind this, and we'll spend some time on this, is the Manichee or Manichaean influence on Augustine. And it's worth spending some time on that, so let's go to the next slide. So when Augustine was a young man, he dabbled with Manichaeism. What is Manichaeism? As you might suspect, the founder's name is Manny. And I don't mean Manny who delivers your pizza or makes it. I mean Manny, who was a soothsayer from the 3rd century in Persia, modern-day Iran. It's interesting, a lot of the mystery religions that afflicted the Roman Empire, they all traveled west into Rome. And Manny, who believed he was an apostle of Jesus Christ, also claimed to have been assisted by direct divine revelation, private revelation. So one of the things that will characterize mystery religions, including Islam, which I'll talk about next week, is the idea of private revelation. In our time, it might be considered Mormonism. Part of the fabric of these religions is that they start with a private revelation. They're not a communal religion in their origins or in their inspiration. But putting that aside for now, and that's a teaser for next week, Mani and Manichaeism, or Mani if you want to call him that, was a dualist. And what I mean by that is that Mani was trying to explain good and evil that was experienced in the world. And this is the paradigm shift that separates the Eastern mystery religions from Greek philosophy. The mystery religions start with dualities in good and evil, and they externalize them. And what I mean by that is that by reflecting on the conflict that we experience in ourselves of good and evil, we're good angels, we're bad angels. As St. Paul says, the good I will, I don't do, and the evil I don't will, I do do. Is that experience of conflict that we all have in our heart. What the folks in the East in the mystery religions tend to do is externalize that. And what I mean by that is they project that into the physical structures of the universe. It becomes a cosmology. a theory of the cosmos. So good is what's light, and evil is matter and dark. So things that are outside of the flesh are good, spirit, light are good, and matter, darkness, fleshy things, heavy things are evil. So a good God created the spiritual world, but he's not omnipotent. He's not all-powerful. There's an evil Satan who disrupts this and creates fallen evil matter and causes this dualism that we live with and this experience of good and evil. And this was a very popular religion because it gave a very clean explanation of good and evil. Because one of the problems early Christians had is, if you believe God is all-powerful and good, how do you explain babies dying without baptism in that time? How do you explain buildings falling on innocent people? Or as Jean-Jacques Rousseau would later say, the Cathedral of Lisbon fell and killed 700 people. How is that the work of a good God? These are real problems that people wanted answers to. And the mystery religions of the East, and in this case, Manichaeism, attempts to solve this problem by saying, you're absolutely right. There is a competition going on in the universe between good and evil. And Jesus Christ is an example of this broader cosmology, of this galactic forces going on between good and evil. Jesus is a disciple of the light, if you will. And through his example, we too can find that light in everyday experiences. So that is the cosmology that underlies Manichaeism, and was very popular in Augustine's time. In fact, at one point, according to some historians, Manichaeism accounted for a third of the world's religions in terms of number of people in this time. So it's not to be discounted as just a side door that Augustine took. He took it seriously, and it influenced him. You can see how it creates a kind of caste system, and there was a caste system in Manichaeism and all of the mystery religions that came from the East. Namely, you had the people in the know, the elect, the true purveyors of wisdom, who could see in a leaf the entire universe and all of its goodness. And then you had what were called the hearers, kind of the freshmen, if you will, in the fraternity, who were not in the inner circle. Augustine was a hearer. He had meetings with the elect and was unimpressed, and eventually did fall away from Manichaeism. But this is important background because you can see how this will ultimately filter into some of Augustine's ideas. And we shouldn't feel shocked that Augustine or any theologian would take the terminology or experiences of his time to use them in Orthodox theology. We do that all the time as well. So that's the background on Manichaeism. I wanted to call out one other influence on Augustine, which is this Platonism. And Platonism has something in common with Manichaeism, very little, but it has one thing at least in common, and it's why it didn't satisfy the human heart, and it didn't satisfy the human heart of Augustine. Platonism is the same externalization. So just as Manny externalized this conflict of good and evil in the human person to the universe, Platonism extends to the universe through the theory of forms that we covered, the experience of how we know and made a universe out of it. So the theory of forms is simply the human experience of knowing something. So you might remember when I was talking about how do we know, when I was talking about Platonism a few weeks ago, how do we know a triangle? Well, we don't know just this red triangle, we know triangle. We know that a triangle has three angles that equal 180 degrees, I hope. We know that a triangle has certain properties always and everywhere, whether it's red, brown, heavy or light, made out of wood or made out of ivory. It's the same property or nature of a triangle. So Plato said we know things through universal concepts. Therefore, I'm going to make things out of them and call them eternal forms. So the same move is going on in Platonism from a method standpoint, from a how do I arrange my philosophy standpoint. I'm merely externalizing how human beings experience knowledge. Manny simply created a cosmology of how human beings experience good and evil. That's the move. And the reason why that doesn't save us, and Augustine found that unsatisfying, is because we're not saved from within. Augustine had a deep sense of his own guilt and his own sinfulness to ever think we could be saved from our own resources. God has to save us from without, from outside of ourselves. And so these philosophies can be useful for the categories they create to advance understanding, but left to themselves, they're godless. Or rather, the human being is being worshipped and elevated and made divine. And so Augustine will ultimately find them as philosophies, as religions, inadequate. But he will cherry pick the categories from these systems of thought to advance orthodoxy, and we should applaud him for that. Are there any questions on this before I continue? Because then we'll get into the quotes from the Confessions. Yes?
Did he have a primary language that changed?
He wrote in Latin and he spoke Latin. There's probably a local language he spoke from North Africa as well, but all of his writings are in Latin. And he actually didn't know much Greek and didn't care for it either. So, yes?
You said he was a hero?
In the Manichaean religion.
Well, isn't that the lower caste?
Yes.
How would he be?
Because there's an initiation that one goes through, and you have to consent to certain progress steps, if you will. And he was on the outside kind of dabbling. Why don't we go to the text of Augustine? And it's really the best way to get a feel for the man is by reading what he wrote. So the Confessions is going to chart his spiritual journey, his wandering, which makes it so interesting and so useful for us to read. And keep in mind, this was written, you know, almost 1,700 years ago. So in the beginning, the Confessions throughout takes the form of a prayer to God. Great art thou, O Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great is thy power, and infinite is thy wisdom. And man desires to praise thee, for he is a part of thy creation. He bears his mortality about with him, and carries the evidence of his sin, and the proof that thou dost resist the proud. Still he desires to praise thee, this man who is only a small part of thy creation. Thou hast prompted him that he should delight to praise thee, for thou hast made us for thyself, and we are restless until we come to rest in thee. So that's that famous quote that was also on your email of tonight's talk. There are different English translations of this. I always tend to pick the translations that are most faithful to the Latin, but also maybe a little clunky. They don't quite have the poetry, but you can see how Augustine is starting out, that there's a restlessness in humanity. And we come to rest only in God. And that really is the theme of this work and all of the works of Augustine. But as we continue reading, he narrates through his childhood and then into adulthood. And as we get into adulthood, it gets more spicy and more interesting because his sensuality kicks in. As we read here, quote, "Thus with the baggage of the world I was sweetly burdened, as one in slumber, and my musings on thee were like the efforts of those who desire to awake, but who are still overpowered with drowsiness and fall back into deep slumber. As no one wishes to sleep forever, for all men rightly count waking better, yet a man will usually defer shaking off his drowsiness when there is a heavy lethargy in his limbs. And he is glad to sleep on, even when his reason disapproves, and the hour for rising has struck. So was I assured that it was much better for me to give myself up to thy love than to go on yielding myself to my own lust. Thy love satisfied and vanquished me, my lust pleased and fettered me." Fettered means enslaved or chained. "I had no answer to thy calling to me, awake you who sleep and arise from the dead, and Christ shall give you light. On all sides thou didst show me that thy words are true, and I, convicted by the truth, had nothing at all to reply but the slow and drowsy words. Presently, see, presently. Leave me alone a little while. That's very modern. That's very modern. A lot of biography of the time, or even later in medieval times, there are no doubts. And this is written by someone, so to speak, who's, we're on his side. We understand what he is struggling with. And sometimes we get frustrated with the saints because they don't show us this side, which makes the recent publication of Mother Teresa's diary so interesting, if you've read that. This, we're with him, and we want to see how it turns out. Continuing then, and here I was, still postponing the abandonment of this world's happiness to devote myself to the search. For not just finding alone, but also the bare search for it, ought to have been preferred above the treasures and kingdoms of this world. So the search should even be preferred to the delights of this world. Better than all bodily pleasures, though they were to be had for the taking. But wretched youth that I was, supremely wretched even in the very outset of my youth, I had entreated chastity of thee and had prayed, grant me chastity and countenance, but not yet. For I was afraid lest thou should hear me too soon, and too soon cure me of my disease of lust, which I desired to have satisfied rather than extinguished. And I had wandered through perverse ways of godless superstition, not really sure of it either, but preferring it to the other, which I did not seek in piety, but opposed in malice. So the transparency, the psychological pouring out here is frankly unparalleled for texts of this time. And we tend to forget this was written 1700 years ago almost. Very uncommon for people to write this way, whereas today there's no shortage of self-help biographies pouring out every last detail, often in mind-numbing detail. So there's an honesty here that is refreshing. And if we continue, quote, it was in fact my old mistresses, trifles of trifles and vanities of vanities who still enthralled me. They tugged at my fleshly garments and softly whispered, are you going to part with us? And from that moment, we will never be with you anymore. And from that moment, will not this and that be forbidden you forever? Almost sounds like the devil in the Garden of Eden. What were they suggesting to me in those words, this or that? What is it they suggested, O my God? Let thy mercy guard the soul of thy servant from the vileness and the shame they did suggest. And now I scarcely heard them, for they were not openly showing themselves and opposing me face to face, but muttering, as it were, behind my back, and furtively plucking at me as I was leaving, trying to make me look back at them. You can almost see, remember the Old Testament story of looking back and turning into the pillar of salt. That allusion would not have gone unnoticed by Augustine either. Still they delayed me, so that I hesitated to break loose and shake myself free of them and leap over to the place to which I was being called. For unruly habit kept saying to me, do you think you can live without them? So he is torn. And I can't do justice in the 90 minutes to all of the imagery he provides and his recollection of his youth and this conversion moment. But this next quotation is his text on his conversion. Quote, I flung myself down under a fig tree, how I know not, and gave free course to my tears. The streams of my eyes gushed out an acceptable sacrifice to thee. And not indeed in these words, but to this effect I cried to thee. And thou, O Lord, how long? How long, O Lord, will thou be angry forever? O remember not against us our former iniquities. For I felt that I was still enthralled by them. I sent up these sorrowful cries, how long, tomorrow and tomorrow. Why not now? Why not this very hour make an end to my uncleanness? I was saying these things and weeping in the most bitter contrition of my heart when suddenly I heard the voice of a boy or a girl, I know not which, coming from the neighboring house, chanting over and over again, Pick it up, read it. Pick it up, read it. Immediately I ceased weeping and began most earnestly to think whether it was usual for children in some kind of game to sing such a song, but I could not remember ever having heard the like. So damning the torrent of my tears, I got to my feet, for I could not but think that this was a divine command to open the Bible and read the first passage I should light upon. For I had heard how Anthony, and this is Saint Anthony the monk, accidentally coming into church while the gospel was being read, received the admonition as if what was read had been addressed to him. And this is what he read: "Go and sell what you have and give it to the poor, and you shall have treasure in heaven, and come and follow me." That's what Anthony read, and that's what led him into the desert. So Augustine continues, "By such an oracle he was forthwith converted to thee. So I quickly returned to the bench where Elpius was sitting," who was a friend of Augustine, later a bishop in North Africa. "For there I put down the apostle's book when I had left there. I snatched it up, opened it, and in silence read the paragraph on which my eyes first fell. Not in rioting and drunkenness, not in chambering and wantonness, not in strife and envying, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to fulfill the lust thereof. I wanted to read no further, nor did I need to. For instantly as the sentence ended, there was infused in my heart something like the light of full certainty, and the gloom of doubt vanished away." So there you have, in a very touching way, described in the Confessions, this conversion story. Some scholars of Augustine would say, like a lot of things, perhaps it did happen in an instant like that. Perhaps many events up to that point in Augustine's life led him to that moment. It doesn't really change the drama of what happened, and it's a very heartwarming and tender and interesting story. And his self-effacing, because keep in mind he's writing this when he's a priest or possibly a bishop, is incredible. And even he will talk in some of his sermons about how his enemies will use his past against him to try to silence him. "Weren't you the guy who was, you know, enslaved by your lusts, and why are you telling us to act this way now?" And so he will talk about that and say that he has charged himself more greater than his opponents ever would. So this is the book 8 of the Confessions. There are actually, I believe, 11 or 12 books in the Confessions. But what makes it this classic of all times in many ways is how different a biography, an autobiography, it was. Many of the biographies of the time, whether you think of the biography of Cyprian, which had such a huge influence in the church in North Africa, or even other saints of the time, Saint Ambrose, the biographies are written differently. They're written as if Saint Ambrose, it was inevitable that he would be a bishop and a saint. Or Saint Cuthbert, another biography written at the time, it's inevitable that he was going to be a saint. That from the time he was a child, he knew he was going to be a bishop and a priest and a saint. There is this triumphalism in the biographies of the time, which served a wonderful purpose of evangelization. In Augustine, we have this very honest portrayal of all the zigs and zags. The compass needle was constantly moving, not pointing true north until toward the end of his life, certainly at middle age. And so this is what is interesting. And the comment I make here is that the other saint biographies almost refer to their conversion as what I call a final destination, or a secure kind of possession. And I call it here a security. And whether it was the ethos of the time of deathbed confessions and baptism saving people at the end of their lives, or whatever it might have been, what makes Augustine's confessions a classic is that it didn't adopt that model of biography. It adopted a very modern model of biography. There's no triumphalism in Augustine's confession. There is no, "I got it right." Although he does say he got it right, but there is still a disquiet, a residue of questioning, even while he gets it right. which makes it uniquely modern and uniquely different from the text written at the time, which is why it's a classic. Exhibit A for this is Book 10, which is written after this conversion story. And I'm snippeting several quotes together because they're all about the same thing. He is pleading with God for self-knowledge because he doesn't trust himself. You would never have a saint writing an autobiography at this time not trusting himself in public in a writing like this. But if, let me read this to you. Command what you wish, but give what you command. In other words, I by myself, even when you tell me what you command, I need your assistance to obtain it. For I cannot easily gather myself together so as to be more clean from this particular infection. I greatly fear my hidden parts, which your eyes know, but not mine. That's a fascinating statement in advance of any kind of modern psychology or psychiatry. Behold, I see myself in you, my truth, but whether I may be like this, I just do not know. I beseech you, God, to show my full self to myself. Saints will always talk about that they most know themselves when they know themselves in Christ. But here we have a psychological discussion and description of it 1,700 years ago. And so that's what makes the confession such a unique work, is that not only is it the journal of a soul, but it is a modern spiritual biography written almost 1,700 years ago. So any questions on the confessions before we continue? I'll make time for one question because we've got more material to go through, which gets to the ideas that Augustine launched in theology or developed. Yes. So the question was, isn't the biography driven by humility? And that's a good point, certainly. And I think it's driven by that, and almost in the writing of it was, I dare to say it, therapeutic for him as well.
The sincerity is outstanding.
The sincerity is outstanding. Yes. Let me keep going, if you'll allow me, and we can take questions at the end as well. Because Augustine, the theologian, is in some ways more important for the church than the confessions themselves, though they are obviously a treasure to the church. So there are many things I could cover. I apologize if I don't cover a theme that you wanted me to cover, but I've only got about 30 minutes left. So. And I could have spent an entire class on the theology of the Trinity, and here it's only going to get one quote, which is terrible, I admit it. So Augustine wrote deeply on the Trinity, and some of it gets complex. But I thought the cleanest way he discusses it at time is to talk along these lines. And so let me read this quote to you and then we'll talk a bit about it. So this is on his work on the Trinity. Quote, "But what is love or charity which divine scriptures so greatly praises and proclaims except the love of good? But love is of someone that loves, and with love something is loved. Behold then, there are three things: he that loves, and that which is loved in love." So Augustine will develop this further in that the Trinity are these terms of love. You have the lover, God the Father, that which is loved, God the Son, and love between them, the Holy Spirit. It's a very interesting way of explaining the Trinity, that if God is love, and God is love, as we know from the New Testament, then what an interesting way to explain the Trinity, that there are three terms to the reality of God, three persons, if you will. He who loves, that which he loves, and love. And that's something actually to help us in prayer as well, or in meditation, because it is the essence of God. God is, as I mentioned before, in our pure, poor human language, a verb, loving. And he does it in three persons. And Bishop Sheen once wrote a book on marriage, It Takes Three to Get Married, the man, the woman, and God. And they also mirror the Trinity in their married love. But for Augustine, the human experience of love is a symbol for the Trinity as well. Now let's go to the other extreme, war. So I've added a little Aquinas on top of Augustine, a little hot fudge sundae on the vanilla ice cream. But Augustine does talk about a just war theory in a very embryonic state. Augustine felt that individual Christians, as individuals, should be pacifists, but that you had an obligation to defend your family and go off to war if need be. So that's kind of an interesting pacifist. He restricted it to your person. And he felt that. But he did lay out some preliminary criteria that Thomas Aquinas will run with later in the Summa Theologica. A just and proper authority who conducts the war. So no tribal private enterprise. It has to be a just authority who is speaking on behalf of a city, let's say, in order to bring those citizens into combat. A just cause, not a war of conquest, but defensive, or what he calls restorative, reclaiming lands that have been taken, for example. That will feel very offensive because you are invading and taking lands. But if you're restoring prior property or lands, it's a just cause. Proper intention to achieve the just result, not to have your eyes on what's next, but rather you're attending to achieve the goal, the stated goal of the action. And a last resort. Other options have been tried before that are reasonable, or they're inadequate, and this is the only option. And so we have, as I say, in an initial form from Augustine, and later developed by Aquinas, a kind of just war theory that's articulated in the City of God. As another tickler for next year, we're in discussions with Father Mike about next year's summer program, and we've selected the social teaching of the Catholic Church, and just war theory will be part of that. So I'm giving you a little teaser of what's coming, and that'll be one of the topics. Interestingly, I mentioned the passage that Augustine comments on in Luke, where Christ is talking to the Roman soldiers, asking him what should he do to be a good soldier, to be saved, and he says, be content with your wages, don't throttle people, but he doesn't tell him to lay down his arms, which is interesting. So, and as I mentioned there, Augustine thought as individuals we should be pacifists, but we could go off to battle for the state or to protect one's family. So that's Augustine on just war theory. More next summer. The controversy with the Donatists. You might say, what's a Donatist? Is it someone who steals donuts? Bless me, Father, for I've sinned. I'm a Donatist. Little Billy, what did you do? I stole three donuts. The Donatists were a group in North Africa. And the origin of them come out of the persecutions from the 3rd century, where you had Orthodox bishops, priests, highly placed Catholic Christians who collapsed under persecution. And the expression was they gave up the books. So you had bishops and priests who collapsed under persecution of the Romans and turned over the scriptures, and the scriptures were burned by the Romans. The persecution subsides, the bishops want back in. The Donatists said, wait a minute, hang on a minute, what's going on here? Are these people worthy to come back? Are the ordinations and baptisms they've conducted since they've come back valid? They've desecrated the church. They're not part of the perfect, which Christians are called to be. So, Donatus, and his followers, and these were a significant group, by the way, and in fact, at some points, they were the majority group of Catholics in North Africa, would argue no, that their ordinations are invalid, their baptisms are invalid, on and on and on. And that the efficacy of a sacrament is based in part on the worthiness of the minister. And in Latin, the scholastics will run with this, ex opere operantis, from the work of the worker. In other words, from the quality of the person performing the sacrament determines that sacrament's validity. This was not a minority view, by the way. In fact, over almost 300 Donatist bishops showed up in around 410 to a council called by the emperor to resolve this question. And Augustine showed up with a large handful of Orthodox bishops. So this was the dominant view in North Africa in the end of the 4th century and the beginning of the 5th century. Augustine and the church will eventually reject this heresy for many reasons, but one of them is that the efficacy of the sacraments comes from Jesus Christ working through that minister, regardless of his worthiness, provided that minister intends to do what the church intends in that sacrament. Ex opere operato, from the work having been worked, not from the minister, but from the work, from the sacrament being properly confected, if I can use that term, according to the mind of the church. The personal worthiness of the minister is not the decisive factor. There was another reason that orthodoxy prevailed over the Donatists. The Donatists, you can see that they were a bit of a joyless group. A lot of their writings articulated standards of conduct that were very hard to attain. And it did create, again, this elite or enlightened level in the Catholic religion as practiced by them. As a result, it was very important that orthodoxy prevailed if we were going to be able to say to all people, you are called to be a son or daughter of Jesus Christ. What the Donatists tended to create was a caste system, once again, of the perfect and the rest of us. And that wasn't going to allow the full membership, if you will, of the human family. And so there's a theological point at stake here, but behind the theology, there's always a practice that will have very significant implications for the life of the church, which is one of the reasons why theology is important, which I talked about it as this boundary around the playing field. If you go outside these boundaries, you can't play the game anymore. You can't play the game of being a son or daughter of Jesus Christ. And so it was very important that orthodoxy won, even though it was the minority position. And it did win, largely due to Augustine's work. Let me continue, because we'll get another flavor of another controversy slash heresy, which was called Pelagianism, named after an ascetical monk from Britain named Pelagius. And Pelagius actually was one of these perfect Christians. This will sound odd because Pelagius is associated with the movement that you don't really need God's grace to begin inhabiting grace or living a grace life. But on your own human volition, if you will, your own steam, you can initiate this life of grace. And what's interesting is that this, again, was very popular. And Pelagius was very well read, very articulate, and he traveled not only throughout what we call the UK, but throughout Rome, and he traveled east. And Augustine eventually took this on. He took it on a bit later than he took on Donatus and the Donatists, but he did get there. Pelagius also denied the doctrine of original sin. He didn't deny that Adam disobeyed God, But that had no real consequences on us other than a bad example. That the effects of that were contained to Adam and Eve. And they were not, there were no real effects of that on us other than creating a situation where we have our first parents creating this bad example. But my choices I can make toward God without the direct aid of God's grace as it was understood in the Orthodox side of the debate. And therein lies the problem. If you think about it, Pelagius is really the last gasp of Stoicism, if this is helpful to you. So if you remember, Stoicism was kind of the philosophy of the stiff upper lip, that if you could understand and unearth what is rational and reasonable by a meditation on nature from a cosmic point of view and align your spirit with it, you could live a good life. Now, Bertrand Russell in the 20th century commented on this and said, well, the Stoics, you could live a good life, but maybe not a happy life. But if you could distract yourself long enough thinking you led a good life, you wouldn't notice you were leading an unhappy life. And so Stoicism ultimately wasn't it's a world-weary philosophy. It's the kind of philosophy that flowers at the end of an empire, which was exactly what was happening. If you read the Meditations of Marcus Aurelius, which were written around 160 AD, 165 AD, they're interesting and they're tiresome to read. When you finish reading them, you think to yourself, is that all you got? You're the emperor of the known world, and this is all you can say. So there's a certain exhaustion about don't place your hopes on wild dreams that are not reasonable. Rather, live your life within the means, the golden means, what's appropriate, what's reasonable. Control your passions and emotions under right reason. Now, there's something that sounds good about that to us as Catholics, but imagine if that's all there was. There's no love in Stoicism. There's just order and good, small g. So in a lot of ways, I think of Pelagian as a Stoic with a cheap Catholic suit on. In that grace is out there, but man can initiate the move to God by choosing it. And this was going to be way too simple for Augustine, because he knew from his own life the winding path that all of us, if we're honest, take toward God. And that it's in fact God's initiative that is always going to be primary and first. And so as I write here, Augustine, building on Paul in the letter to the Romans, that the sin of one man, Adam, did unleash this disorder into the universe and into us. We're good, but we're wounded. So we are inclined to bad things, but we were made for the good, is another way of putting it. An original sin weakens a human nature that was meant for God. And as such, left to ourselves, we cannot make it. And so Stoicism and Pelagius in many ways were these almost antiseptic Christians. They didn't countenance the drama of what it means to be a Christian each and every day. And as a result, the doctrine of original sin takes on greater depth under Augustine, where he says, yes, the consequences of Adam and Eve's sin are communicated to us through procreation and human sexuality, which is why human sexuality in Augustine gets a little negativity at times, which we don't have time to go into unless you ask about it. But as a result, original sin is real, and therefore God's offer to us first is necessary and real. And so Augustine maintains both poles of this mystery of God moves us freely to a graced act, to a meritorious act. And a good definition of heresy is an impatience with the mystery. They want to resolve it. And orthodoxy loves to keep them in tension and keep them going, because it's human to resolve it falsely, and it's divine to keep the mystery. And that's where our sanity will come from as well, when we talk about it, and our sanctity, when I get to it in class 8, our last class. So Augustine affirms the initiative of God is always first with us as we act freely. So we act freely under the impulse of God's action. It sounds like a contradiction, doesn't it? But it's our nature to be free, and God moves things according to their nature. Herein lies the mystery, that God can move us freely to a graced act, a meritorious act. That's the heart of the mystery. How does that happen? But the Pelagian heresy, I mentioned it's the last gasp of Stoicism of the Roman world. We see some of it playing out today in Christian preaching. Not necessarily from Catholic pulpits, but from other pulpits, that we respond to God's grace. God invites us, and this sounds very Catholic, but we always have to remember God invites us, and our response is itself graced by God. Oftentimes, people neglect that second part. There's kind of a unconscious Pelagianism going on of God invites us, we respond. Oh, yeah, that sounds fair. but it's not orthodox unless we understand our response as itself graced. And then common in our culture is the I'm okay, you're okay. If I'm sincere, my truth is my truth is your truth, and therefore I am graced. And that's a very convenient thing to affirm. But it's not necessarily a Catholic response. And maybe I could have dwelled on this more, but Pelagius was concerned about what he was seeing. Forced conversions and the idea that if God commands something that we can't attain without him, how is that fair? How is it a good God that offers us heaven, but we can't get there without him, and therefore if we don't, we're going to hell? There's something unfair about that. And what Augustine's response to that is manifold, but his response will be that God's offer is always first, and that doesn't diminish human capacity, it actually extends it to the supernatural. And the quote he will often say is, God who created you without you can't save you without you. And it's true. And so Pelagian was kind of preaching this, I call it antiseptic Christianity, of Christianity without grace at the beginning. Whereas Augustine, through his own personal experience and his pastoral experiences, knew that God's grace was needed every moment. That we're not some kind of static thing like a pile of rocks, but we're a dynamic living thing. And that one choice on Monday doesn't mean the same choice on Tuesday. So Augustine will develop this whole theology of memory and of habit, that our habits can drive us in a direction. And if you have bad habits, how do you ever get off that track? God's grace. Or the memory of past sins. How do I overcome terrible memories of things I've done in the past? How do I release myself from the slavery of my past sins if I have a memory of them? God's grace. So Pelagian almost preached this antiseptic, I keep using that word, as if I had no memory of yesterday, as if my disposition and habits from yesterday have no impact on me today. It's an unreal elitist philosophy, theology. It's why I call it Stoicism under a different guise. So, the key heresies of his time are undone. The mystery religion from the East, Manichaeanism, the elitism of the Donatists, of the perfect are the only true Catholics and the only true Catholic bishops, is undone. The Stoicism of Pelagianism is defeated and Orthodoxy is reinstated. The path is now clear to Christianize the world. We tend to minimize this, that medieval Europe was not inevitable. Saint Benedict will say we are waiting for a new Benedict, and we are. I also think we're waiting for a new Charlemagne. The political and military forces, if you will, also have to align to drive Christian society. So politics is part of the mix. But my main point is the road is now open theologically that orthodoxy prevails and leads this trajectory to Charlemagne and beyond, to the founding of Europe. So with that, I've just got a few minutes left. Let's go to some just quick quotes that I've always enjoyed reading. This first set are from the City of God. Quote, "The centuries of past history would have rolled by like empty jars if Christ had not been foretold by them. These were the two motives which drove the Romans to their wonderful achievements: liberty and passion for the praise of men. What else was there for them to love save glory? For through glory they desired to have a kind of life after death on the lips of those who praise them. But the heavenly city outshines Rome beyond comparison. There instead of victory is truth, instead of high rank, holiness, instead of peace, happiness, instead of life, eternity. Take Aristotle, put him near the rock of Christ and he fades away into nothingness. Who is Aristotle? When he hears the words Christ said, then he shakes in hell. Pythagoras said this, Plato said that. Put them near the rock and compare these arrogant people with him who was crucified. And then on the love of God and eternal life, and these come from his sermons, and the second one comes from his sermon on John's Gospel. This quote, he was talking about Pelagius. One of his comments against Pelagius was that he was not in love. Give me a man in love. He knows what I mean. Give me one who yearns. Give me one who is hungry. Give me one far away in the desert who is thirsty and sighs for the spring of the eternal country. Give me that sort of man. He knows what I mean. But if I speak to a cold man, he just doesn't know what I'm talking about. And then on John, you are surprised that the world is losing its grip, that the world has grown old. Don't hold on to the old man, the world. Don't refuse to regain your youth in Christ, who says to you, the world is passing away. The world is losing its grip. The world is short of breath. Don't fear. Thy youth shall be renewed as an eagle." So that is the summary on St. Augustine. I know that was brief. I know I bypassed successfully questions. There's a last page, a bibliography of a really the best work I've come across on the life of Augustine by Peter Brown. I would encourage you to get the most recent edition. Anytime a biography has a second edition 45 years later with a new afterword, you know it's a good biography. And if you are interested in Augustine, I would suggest that you purchase that. So thank you. Next week is St. John of Damascus, and we'll wrap it up then.